Now, who are the elders? Well, people like Kofi Annan and Desmond Tutu, leading world figures who are warning about the threat of climate change. And two more of its number, Jimmy Carter and Mary Robinson, are in Paris this Tuesday to keep the pressure on leaders over the issue. Now, for more, I'm joined in studio by Rajendra Shende. You were of the United Nations Environment Programme. You're now chairman of the TERRE Policy Centre. Mr. Shende, world leaders are due to agree a new international climate deal in Paris in 2015. Today's event is all about trying to keep the pressure up for bold action in December. What more can you tell us?
Well, I think such pressure events had happened in the past, particularly in the Copenhagen meeting a few years back, where there was a tremendous pressure of political leaders to do something about it. But I think this time is going to be different. And I feel that it's going to be very action-oriented persuasion because of the reports which have come out from the IPCC, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which gives a very dire warning, much dire and much sort of a blaring wake-up call for the society to take actions. So this time is going to be different, and I think 2015, the Paris meeting of climate change is going to be the world focus.
Okay, what are the major current log jams to reaching an accord in December? And is the French government in a good position now to influence a positive outcome, do you think?
I'm not sure whether the French government is in a position, but I think they have an opportunity to make a difference. And I think that difference is much needed by the whole world. The main logjam would be in a form of a trust between poor countries, not so poor countries, and the rich countries. And this has been a major sort of a block in moving ahead. But there are a number of other issues in terms of whether the emerging economies would take targets the way the rich countries are asked to take targets, or whether the rich countries and emerging countries can join together to help the very poor countries. There is also an issue of funding and finances which are needed by the poor countries to adapt to the climate change. So I think these are the major issues which are very severe. They have been persistently coming up in last two decades, but I think they are not insurmountable. And I think the France 2000 meeting has an opportunity to cross those log jams and make the world a better place in terms of climate change.
Now, we know the stories are regular, but can you remind us again what the current warnings are, scientific warnings, about where we're at now with global warming and climate change?
Well, the warnings have come from the group of scientists and experts from all over the world. There are more than about 800 experts which have come under the umbrella of United Nations Environment Programme and World Meteorological Organization, and that is a body called as IPCC, which is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. And they have been holding a regular assessment of science, impacts, and the solutions. And that has been going on since 1990. And just 6 months back, we have these three important reports which have come up, which is called as a fifth assessment report, where I think the observations have got stronger, the model has developed much better, and better technologies are available to predict. And now we are trying to get into the what is called as a mathematical games, that we are able to tell now in a very particular way, in a very specific way, what are the percentage of probability that climate change is due to the human actions, what kind of devastating effects and impacts it would have on the world, and how the world will suffer, and how much is the cost required, and how much growth we will have to sacrifice for doing this. But I think the signals are sort of very blaring, as I said in the beginning. And I think the world has now to wake up to this reality to take the actions. And the report also are quite optimistic in saying that we have probably the last opportunity to take the actions. And the window is not totally closed for getting into what is called as a decarbonized economy, or getting out of what is this carbon addiction or carbon slavery, and also getting rid of what is, I call it myself personally, a climate apartheid. That there is a gap between what climate will do to the rich countries and what it will do to the tropic countries. And also the cause and effect relationship and the societal role it has historically played into it.
And in previous roles you've held, you've worked closely with developing countries in that regard. How now can we ensure that developing countries, that the most vulnerable countries, are protected in any deal that's reached?
Well, the deal has not yet reached. And when it will be reached, I think, which is necessary now, the poor countries need to be taken care in order to protect them. The trouble is, these are the poor countries who have done nothing to cause the present problem. But they will be suffering the most because they are most vulnerable. They are the weakest part of it. And they have been demanding number of actions, the technological actions to protect themselves. Simple thing is the sea coastline barricades. It could be saving them from the food security which will come. The food shortages will come because of the droughts, from the floods. And I think these are the measures. There are the measures which are required by the support need to be provided by the developed countries. It has been demanded that about $100 billion per year is needed by the poor countries for adapting to the climate change.
But we know how difficult it has been to move this whole process on over recent years. We even saw a very emotive plea by the Philippines representative last year. You know, what is it going to take really to reach a deal?
I think this is what exactly is now needed when we talk about this dialogue of elders. We have done all sorts of efforts over the last two decades to get the people together. We have used the multilateralism to make sure that the things keep on progressing. But we have not seen the real progress. When I mean real progress, is the progress which can really tackle the problem. Not the progress here and there, which just inches towards our goal. I think now that process has to be given up. And I think we have to take a very, very fast role, move away ahead fast. And this is probably where the elders can play a role in inspiring the people. Like Nelson Mandela, on apartheid, the society was very slow in taking action. I think he's the one, through his personal dedication, showed, proved, implemented, and now he has become a model. I think the same thing should happen in case of climate change.
And briefly, what's your message to viewers, to citizens? How can they now get involved in this? How can they try and propel this towards a deal?
I think one thing is the communities and the individuals are in fact showing a good sign and awareness and some practical measures. What is now needed is a cooperative action. These communities have to come together. There have to be institutions to drive these communities further. Some kind of political willingness by the government to make sure that such kind of like-minded communities come together. And this is what exactly the elders can do by addressing the students in Science Po, that they are the tomorrow's policy makers, and they can start making sure that such small efforts at community level can be institutionalized and globalized so that we can achieve our objective of limiting the temperature rise to 2 degrees centigrade.
Rajendra Shende, thank you very much for coming into us. You're from the TERRE Policy Centre. Thank you very much for telling us all about
the
elders meeting.
Thank you for inviting me.
Very good.
Bye-bye.